A very hearty good afternoon to one and all present here. I welcome you all to the second session of Research Scholar Day. I call upon stage our coordinator, Hisse Lama, to please take the session forward.
Thank you, Sivani. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this panel discussion on a subject titled Future of Basic Scientific Research in India, Challenges and Prospects. So I warmly and respectfully welcome all panel members for making their presence despite of their regular busy schedule. So I would like to introduce the panelists. First, Professor G. Baskaran is our guest of honor for today's panel discussion. He is a theoretical physicist at Indian Institute of Mathematical Science, Chennai, and he works on condensed matter physics and strongly correlated matter. So I request our Dean of Academic Research to hand over a gift to Professor G. Baskaran. Now we have a Professor Ajit K.Kembhavi. He's an astrophysicist, currently the director of Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics, Pune. So I ask our Dean of Academy Research to hand over a gift. Now we have Professor V. Balakrishnan. He's a theoretical physicist at Department of Physics, IIT Madras, and his research interests are dynamical system stochastic process. Now we ask Dean to hand over the gift. Now we have Professor Enakshi Bhattacharya. She is an experimentalist at Department of Electrical Engineering at IIT Madras and currently working in the area of microelectronics and mechanical system and sensor. So I request our Dean to hand over the gift. Now we have Professor P.B. Sunil Kumar. He is a theoretical physicist and currently HOD of Department of Physics, IIT Madras. His area of interest is soft matter system, including polymer and membranes. Now we have Professor Ronojoy Adhikari. He's a theoretical physicist at IMSC. His area of interest is soft matter system. And finally, we have Professor Sriramkumar L. He's a theoretical physicist working with gravitation and cosmology department of physics. So he will be going to moderate this session. Thank you, sir, for presenting the memento. Now I request Dr. Sriram to moderate the session. So kindly, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. I have been requested to moderate this session. From what I understand, the title is given as Future of Basic Scientific Research in India, Challenges and Prospects. And as I said, from what I understand, the students are interested in the following issue, so to say. The Indian scientific community is recognized for their significant contributions in research and innovation. However, it is often stated that we lag far behind the world leaders in scientific research due to several reasons. And I believe the students are interested in understanding as to how one can improve at an individual level as well as at a collective level to improve their quality of research. There are three topics that we would like the panelists to comment on this afternoon. And the first is the importance of research in basic science in India, and what role can it play in India's growth, economic and otherwise. And the second topic is as follows. You know, we would like to hear the panelists' view as to where do we stand in terms of the quality of our research, both at the individual level and at a collective level. And the third topic being, how should young researchers go about the challenge of improving the quality of their research, and how can improving the quality of research at an individual level can move India collectively forward? What I intend to do is that I intend to repeat these questions, state these questions once, and I will request the panelists to comment on this topic one by one. And then after all the panelists have commented, I intend to open the floor for a few questions at the end of each topic. And after we have discussed all three topics towards the end, we'll again open the floor for further questions. So let me repeat the topic one, and I will request the panelists to comment on the topic. The question is as follows. Can the panelists comment on the importance of research in basic science? What role can it play in India's growth? I would request Professor K.Kembhavi to make his comments to start with.
Good afternoon. Actually, we have had a very interesting discussion this morning through the talks and then the small little thing that we said and also the question answers. So much of this has been discussed there already. But now we can consider going into it in a little bit detail. When you say that the importance of research in basic science, the question of what should one be doing research on things like the Higgs boson or in astronomy or condensed matter and things like that, which do not have immediate applications. Now, it's clearly important for people like us because we have been doing it all our life. But the question is, does the country think that it is important? So that is a very, in my opinion, that is very important. Do other people perceive basic research by people like us to be important? Are they going to encourage it? Are they going to support it? So now, as you all know, India, soon after independence, developed wonderful institutions. They have had a very good tradition of research before, but it was primarily in the universities. But it was realized that we should get into basic research quite fast. So the Indian Institute of Science or the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research was set up very early after our independence. And then there are many institutions now. Over the recent years, you see that there is absolutely no stagnation. Meaning that when I was beginning my research in the 1970s, and Baskaran and I were strict contemporaries, everybody thought that they're no longer going to get jobs in research. And before that, you just did a PhD in a place like the IFR, you went abroad immediately, then you got a job. So people are beginning to get afraid that you're not going to get jobs. And a lot of people left. For example, the current Deputy National Security Advisor is somebody who was doing his research in TIFR, a few years younger than me. He was one of the people who left in a panic. So, but now there seems to be a new resurgence. But just look at the number of ISERs which have been set up and which are there to primarily promote basic research among young people. And then this morning we were told how the number of research students in IITs is going up. Not all of them are doing basic research, but all of them are doing research. Right? So it is clear that there are people who believe that it is important. Then if you look at the number of people who vie for a position in ISERS, both as students or as teachers, it is phenomenal. But especially for some of the ISERS, every position which is open, there are 70 or 80 applications, both from excellent places in India as well as from abroad. So which means that it is really not true to say that interest in basic research is going down amongst the people. It seems to be increasing, if anything. Then interest in basic research is going up in the government because the government is providing a great deal of support. Now, there may be some questions about the way in which the support is channelized or the way in which certain places are administered and so on, but the basic yearning for doing research is there. And I believe that that is because it is realized that letting people do basic research is important not only from not only just to keep them their minds elevated and the intellect stimulated, but also as an important driver of talent and skills in the country, which will lead to economic growth. Okay, so it is really, I don't think that basic research is any manner in danger. Some of the biggest projects which have been approved in recent times are astronomy projects, to build very large telescopes or to build gravitational wave detectors, the neutrino observatory, and so on. So all is well for basic science.
Thank you, Professor K.Kembhavi. Before I hand over the microphone to Professor Baskaran, I would just like to mention, students will be circulating some chits of paper. If you have a question to ask in this regard, I would just request you to write the question and hand over to the students who are circulating. Just raise your hand and stay where you are. People will come and hand you over a sheet of paper. Professor Baskaran.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for inviting me to this very nice gathering of research scholars. So I will make few comments, mostly historical comments, to emphasize the importance of research in basic science. In the middle of 1850 or 1860, Maxwell, who could have been contended with Gauss's law or Ampere's law or Faraday's law, tried to put them together in the form of differential equations. There was no necessity to do that. He did it. It's inquiring into nature of the laws in the form of, you know, trying to see it in the form of differential equations. And then nature revealed to him that here is a wave equation. A wave equation will support a wave and it will move with some velocity, which was incomprehensibly high, velocity of light. So that was a prediction that came from a very simple basic science. Then after a few decades, electromagnetic waves were discovered experimentally. Now the world has become small because of that particular discovery. You can enumerate any number of such examples. Einstein's theory of relativity, mass energy equivalence. Then Einstein's general theory of relativity, which looked very abstract, very soon gave insight into the very beginning of the universe in the form of various solutions and so on. And then very quickly, astronomy grew into a big science, now one of the most powerful scientific activities in the world now. And the kind of side effects that I had, including the cell phone and cameras that you have, all came because you wanted to see the stars wanted to capture the faint light using charge coupled devices and so on. And coming to my own field of condensed matter physics, some group of people wanted to understand the basic quantum mechanical behavior of electrons in periodic solid. So concepts like valence bond, conduction band, holes, and so on came. Then very quickly, including a theorist named John Bodin, they built a transistor which has changed the face of the world. So I think that importance of basic science is very, very transparent and obvious. Things may not happen immediately, but it's a matter of time. So if you look at any significant development in science and technology, it was maybe 10 years ago or 20 years ago, there are roots in some very important basic science development. Now whether it's going to play any important role in India's growth, obviously yes. India is one of the few countries which are in the forefront now, developing and so on. If you look at any successful countries, be it United States or big countries in Europe, their strength, I believe, is not lying because they have a lot of money. It's because they have great universities. They have produced a great understanding of nature, which is pushing the whole world together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Baskaran. Professor Balakrishnan.
Once again, I'd like to thank all those concerned for inviting me to be here. I'd like to address this question with a single answer as to the question of the importance of research and basic science for this country. It is absolutely essential. There's just no two opinions about it. A little bit of history along the lines that a little more recent history than what Professor Baskaran mentioned. Initially, when we gained independence, there was actually a bit of mixed advice given to the then Prime Minister, to Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. There were those who felt, foreign experts, there were many of them who felt that India did not need basic science and that we could get away with just applied research, we could get away with applied physics, specifically standards, institutions, and so on. But basic research could take a back seat or something like that. But fortunately, there were counterweights to it. There was the DAE under the stewardship of Homi Bhabha, who was very strongly for basic research, as well as the presence at that time of such stalwarts as Saha, Raman, and Bose. And it was this advice was not taken literally, and research institutes were set up in large numbers. So at that stage, we avoided a wrong turn. And this was very, very useful, as events proved. Now, there are just two things that I want to mention, which I think would require re-examination and re-evaluation after so many years have passed, 65 odd years. The first is that I think there should be much closer synthesis or interaction between basic research in all the sciences and teaching institutions. This is absolutely crucial. For historical reasons, we grew in two parallel streams. There were the university system, the IITs, and now the ICERs and so on were set up. At the same time, autonomous research institutes were set up in very large numbers. I think now the time has come when this should be re-examined, this whole question, and a much closer reintegration of research institutes and teaching institutions, I think, is called for. I think that's of paramount importance, because it has sunk in rather slowly, but it has sunk in now, that the raw material for all the research institutes comes from the teaching institutions, and that these two things cannot really be divorced to the extent they have unfortunately been in this country. So this requires much, much closer integration of these two sets of institutions, which I hope will be the direction in which we'll move. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Balakrishnan. Professor Bhattacharya.
I'll start with, of course, thanks for calling me to be a panelist. I'm the odd man out. And pun fully intended, I don't know if I'm a physicist or an engineer. My training was physics, but I've spent past 23 years in an engineering department. I'm sitting in the august presence of all theoretical physicists. Is basic science theoretical physics? Okay, can physics just be theoretical physics? So I don't even understand what is basic science. Is basic science that is not applied, or are we talking about short-term or long-term applications? Most science, you know, the other day there was a talk by Professor Heath, and he quoted Rutherford and various people saying chemistry doesn't have enough equations. And so whatever it is, physical science, engineering, we need experimental work, we need observations, we need verifications of, you know, that's why LHC is getting built, because finally you have to verify everything experimentally. Okay, the way the labs are in schools, high schools, in colleges, science colleges, engineering colleges, it's pathetic. They all have a computer lab. Every school has a language lab, has computer labs. But look at the experiments. Even when we were students, experiments never used to run. It used to be a horror. You know, when you had practical examination in front of the external examiner, they used to work even worse, right? So people just get put off by experimental work. And we cannot make any progress unless both go simultaneously hand in hand. But I would say, you know, theoretical physics doesn't need a large investment. Of course, now we don't have paper and pencil theoretical physicists. Everyone uses computers and they are expensive. So I can't even give that experimental physics is more expensive. There is now money in India, and at least the last 7-8 years, I would say funding is very good. But now comes, earlier we used to say we can't do this because there isn't enough funding. But funding is again not enough. People talk about ecosystem. Now we understand what the ecosystem is. Too few groups, everything has to be imported. The system goes down, you have to wait for, you know, not just funding, even if you have money, you don't have people to repair it. So to make an impact, basic science, I would call any research that is done for gaining knowledge and understanding, which might lead to application. You know, what would you call Faraday? Was he an engineer? Was he a physicist? Or closer home, G.C. Bose. What was he? Was he a physicist? Was he a biologist? Was he an inventor? He actually made the instrument to find if plants have life, right? So I think we have to first of all, you know, redefine basic science, and we have to cut all these boundaries between engineering and science, between experimentalists and theoreticians, and only then there'll be progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Bhattacharya. Professor Adhikari.
Good afternoon, and thank you for having me here in this very august company. I'm somewhat overwhelmed, and you know, since so many useful and correct things have already been said, it's a little hard act to follow and, you know, say anything useful after this. I think I'll just follow some of the threads that my previous panelists have brought up. One of these is that I think the distinction between basic and applied research is a fairly recent one. Even 200 years back, if you had gone back and asked a researcher, what do you do? If you had asked Maxwell, perhaps, what do you do? I don't think he would have necessarily had this distinction in him that I'm doing basic versus applied research, because on the one hand, he was, you know, working with the mathematics of electromagnetism. On the other hand, he was doing experiments on the viscosity of water. And so I think this distinction that has come about between basic and applied research is more or less an artifact of the last maybe 50, 75 years. And like my previous panelist mentioned, I think this is a distinction which probably needs to be broken down. This sort of artificial dichotomy between what is applied and what is basic probably needs to be broken down. I think it's a particularly severe situation in India where we have this dichotomy very strongly emphasized. In particular, the dichotomy between basic research and applied research, between theoretical work and experimental work. I think as soon as these dichotomies are broken down and there's a better integration between all of these things, we'll have a better and more healthy research ecosystem in India. Thank you.
Thank you, Adhikari. Professor Sunil Kumar.
Sir, I also thank the organizers for having me here. I also had the same doubt. That's like, you know, what is basic science research, or in fact even the title itself, whether it is research in basic science or basic scientific research, or what are we talking about, and what does that actually mean? Okay, I also had this question. So, but I kind of take it that we are talking about science which is not industrially driven, or directly applied to some industrial product. That's what we are talking about. So that kind of research is what we're talking about, basic research here. And taking that, we have already saw from the previous panelists that, you know, this has implications in economic growth, and it has implications in industrial growth and things like that. So I wanted to just point out one more thing. So when my point on this is that, you know, a basic science education and a basic science research is extremely important for a country, because it builds a society which is based on rational thought and logical reasoning. And I think if a society is built on rational thought and logical reasoning, and then, you know, the existing social structure and social hierarchy, etc., does not stun our questioning and our progress. And I think that is the most important aspect, as far as I see, of supporting basic research. However industrially developed, however developed the countries, we still need to have supporting, and however poor the countries, we still need to support basic science, because it really builds rational thought.
Thank you, Professor Sunil Kumar. Now it's open for questions. Are there any questions? Has any papers been circulated? There are. Can you pass them on? Okay, the first question is, students are divided towards engineering, or diverted towards, I'm sorry, towards engineering instead of basic science. Is this because there are less number of jobs in basic science? Sundaraj from mechanical engineering. Is there anyone from the panel who would like to comment about it?
Yeah. Ajit. I would like to understand Ajit the question
then
better.
Enakshi.
Pardon me? Who do you think diverts you from basic science into engineering? Meaning the parents or the teachers or society or who? Everyone. It's called the cosmic conspiracy. Okay, but I feel that there's plenty of opportunity for ghar vapsi, okay, because see the about I would think that in my institute, which is a very small thing, so it's prone to statistical fluctuations, but over the last 25 years, about 40% of the people who come for research are from the engineering stream, and our advertisement clearly says, and all the jest things clearly say, that you either need a master's in science, in physics or mathematics, or you need a BTEC or a BE, right? So, and then 40% of the students are there, and those who come don't really want to work on telescopes and things like that. They all want to work on quantum gravity, right? So there's a bit of a movement back and forth, and your parents or your teachers or your well-wishers always want you to do something where there are obviously more jobs, more growth, but that can be taken care of at a later time.
Professor Bhattacharya.
So I think this came with the IT jobs. You know, we were happy to do science. And now if someone doesn't get into engineering and has to do science, they look like the sky has fallen on their head. Oh no, I have to go to college to study physics. But the subjects have not changed. And it's not that after doing engineering, you'll get good jobs. We see that seats lie empty. So hopefully now it's turning back again.
Anyone else wish to? Sunil, please.
I think the idea that there is more jobs in engineering than in science is a myth. And I think it is mostly that if you're good and then there are jobs. If you're not good, the jobs are harder to come by. That's all it is. We see that when we advertise for any position here, even for a small technical position, we get a large number of applications from BE graduates. Actually, BE, Electronic and Communication Sciences, is one of the most common the applications we get, and we find that they cannot do anything. Okay, and while somebody who is much lower qualified is able to do this job much better. Okay, so I think that's a myth, right? That there is more jobs in engineering, so we all have to do engineering. I don't believe that.
Any other comments?
Yeah.
Please. Professor Balakrishnan.
I just want to add one little adjective to what Sunil said, when he said if you're good, there are jobs. If you're not so good, there may not be that many jobs. I'd like to add that if there's also a little emotional aspect to it. The question is, how do you know you're good at something? If you're happy doing it, you'll be good. And if you're good at it, you'll be happy doing it. So these two go together.
Thank you. The next question, there are two questions from Shiju John. I will read the first one first. What is the role of ICERs and NICER in building a culture of basic science and research in India, and how are they progressing? Anyone? Yeah, please go ahead, Professor Balakrishnan.
I think all academics and thoughtful people are agreed that this artificial distinction in science between the experimental, the computational, and the pure, quote-unquote, part of the science is artificial, completely artificial, as is, to a good extent, these divisions between applied and basic research or pure research and so on. In exactly the same way, I think, I've lost track of what this question actually wanted to get at.
What is the role of ICERs and NICERs in building a culture of basic science? How are they progressing?
There were initial efforts to make the IITs Indian Institutes of Science and Technology. Should have been done, in my opinion, then many of these problems would not have arisen. In fact, in the early days, if I remember right, Professor Sena Rao, when he first went to Kanpur, made serious efforts to get the name of the institute changed to the Indian Institute of Science and Technology, or Technology and Science, the order doesn't matter. So tried to do this. Unfortunately, at that time, he didn't succeed. There was a lot of resistance. I wish he had succeeded, because then many of these later issues would not have cropped up. Now it's true that the ICERs and NITs and the IITs and so on are doing pretty much the same thing. Their endeavor is more or less the same thing. The subjects they focus on may be slightly different, but I think it's not just the ICERs, it's also the IITs. The whole point of the IITs, regardless of their name, was that these were set up as institutions, not as polytechnics. They were very specifically set up as institutions of higher technology, which also implies science automatically. So although in many of the engineering colleges of that day, the science departments were regarded as service departments, as very often these days, even sometimes the humanities departments are in many institutions, that was not true in general, at least not officially not true in the IITs. So they too have contributed a great deal. And the advent of the ICERs has now accelerated the process. So it's really a good thing. Because ultimately, when you want to call something a university, you have to justify the name. You cannot do two subjects and call it a university. It violates the meaning of the word university. You need all disciplines. You need people with all kinds of talent, all kinds of ways of thinking in order to make it an integrated whole. And I think all these institutions, regardless of their names, will eventually evolve towards that. They have to, otherwise they'll be stagnant.
Any other comments?
Can I?
Sure.
I got a direct answer. I think that the ICERs have been around just for 5 years, 5-6 years, and the first batches of research students are just coming out. So it's a little bit too early to say. But if you look at the faculty and if you look at the students, then you'd say that the initial conditions are good. But whether they contribute in a systematic fashion to raise the tenor of science in the country, we'll have to wait all 10, 15 years to see that.
Professor Baskaran.
My immediate impression after meeting several ICER faculty, it's not all microphone.
Awesome.
Okay. This is on now.
So my immediate impressions after meeting several ICER faculties is very positive. So I go to meetings, workshops, and so on. Previously used to get people from IAC, IITs, and some universities. Now there is equal number from ICERs, all young faculties in very different fields. So and I think it will grow well. That's my, and contribute to basic science.
The Shiju John had a second question as well. It reads as follows. Do you feel that politics need to be taken out from all educational institutions so that we can embrace science without other distractions? Sure, please go.
I have a, with no offense intended, I have a little bit of an anecdote to relate in regard to this question. Many years ago, I was giving a talk somewhere in Calcutta on complexity, complex systems. Complexity had just become popular. And I was pointing out that the tools used in the analysis of complex systems were common not just to physics and chemistry and biochemistry, biology, ecology, meteorology, economics, sociology, linguistics, and so on. A lot of the tools, analysis, statistical analysis, and so on are common. At that stage, Professor Bikash Sinha pointed out, he intervened and said, what about politics? And my instant reaction was, I'm going to stick to mentionables. So I would still like to say we should stick to mentionables.
Sure, please go ahead, Professor. Are there any other questions? No. Okay. Maybe we can hand over the microphone.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I would like to say, you also put some light upon the recent building which is going on of Indian neutrino.
Maybe that's simply out of place at this stage. Maybe we can come back to these questions towards the end. If there are additional questions you would like to ask the panelists, maybe we will come back to that later. We will stick to this topic at this stage. Okay. So let's move on to the second topic then. The second question that the students have posed is as follows. In your view, where do we stand at present in terms of the quality of research being carried out? Professor K.Kembhavi. You may need to leave and hence.
I'll leave in anger. This is a complicated question. And I would think that the best research is very good. Okay, but like it was said in the morning, we have not had Tendulkars for a long time in science, in physics, for example, or in other science. So I, when that talk was being given, I was just thinking about it and I realized that one could talk in terms of three different layers. One is that if you go to the best places in the world where research is done, and I think in terms of physics because that's my subject, but the same applies to more or less unchanged to all kinds of research. I don't even want to make a distinction between basic and applied. So if you go to the best places in the US or go to the University of Cambridge or whatever, you reach certain heights there. And one of the measures of the heights is the highest accolades you can get, Nobel Prizes, Fellows of the Royal Society, and so on. we don't have too many of those cases in India over recent years. Okay, then there is the performance of people of Indian origin who have done their PhD here or done the master's here and gone abroad and settled down there. And you see that their performance reaches a certain level again, and some of them have reached the best things, and all the Nobel Prizes outside of peace have been for people of Indian origin who have been outside. Okay, and then there are people who work in India, who have grown up in India, who may have done their PhD in India or abroad, but basically work here. And you find that the very good research here is very good by world standards, but it doesn't hit the peaks. We really don't know why that is happening. Okay, and then you have got what you would call the middle level research. So in any given laboratory, you've got people who are exceedingly good and people who are average. the quality of the lab is determined by the quality of the average people. Okay, so the better the lab, the better the quality of the average, but there's an average there, which again compares well with the average in more developed countries. But then when you go below that, there is a lot of research which is not of very high quality. Okay, so there's a very great deal of it. When you talk about so many scientists in India or so many graduates, the tail end, which is very long and which is very populous, is actually not of very high quality. And we essentially need to increase the quality there in order to push the average up substantially. And that is very, very difficult to do, okay, because of various circumstances over which people like us may not have control. So it has to be done at a different level. So one has to be careful in making distinctions between these levels in deciding whether the research is good or bad.
Professor Baskaran.
So the question is, where do we stand at present in terms of
quality
of research? It's a very difficult question, but in general, I wanted to comment about research. I have written down here, we are limping along, and the best is yet to come. In terms of, you know,
if I can interject briefly, I think it is related to the original thing. I think what students are wondering is, you know, Indian scientific community is recognized for the significant contribution. However, simultaneously, we are said we are on the average. And that's the concern, essentially.
So there are, you know, individuals who do very well in spite of various circumstances and so on. But on the whole, our, I don't know, maybe I'm not answering the question correctly. In terms of quality, I mean, it's average quality, as
exactly.
You said, is there are problems. In fact, Balakrishnan will agree that if you think about quality of research from individuals or from institutions in India, it's one of the most broad random variable. The quality really has fantastic fluctuation.
Exactly.
I think, whereas if you go to developed countries, it's much narrower. There are so-called, you know, universities which is in the 100th rank and 10th rank. There is not much difference. Here it's extremely broad spread of quality. So to that extent, you know, people look at the tail and say that it's bad. But there are good people. Thank you.
Professor Balak.
Yeah, I agree entirely with what Professor K.Kembhavi and Baskaran have said. In fact, I've noted down here, the quality is very mixed, really mixed. It's a huge distribution. It reflects the diversity of our institutions also and our conditions. It's a huge country from extreme poverty to extreme wealth, and exactly the same is true in science, extreme poverty to very rich content in science and technology. So we have very distinct strengths, very distinct weaknesses also. On the whole, it has been said very often by many people, observers from outside, that our strengths lie in theoretical and abstract thinking, and our weaknesses lie in practical and applied work. This seems to have been an opinion which has been formed by many people after they have observed India. I don't know if that's correct or not, because we have had the world's best artisans right from the beginning of history, so it's not clear to me that we should tell ourselves we are not good with our hands. It's certainly not true at all. But we have strengths and weaknesses. And again, even in the sciences, even in the basic sciences, we have work now in experimental work in chemistry and biology and subjects of that kind, which are absolutely world-class work. So we shouldn't, I think, whip ourselves or imagine, fool ourselves, delude ourselves into thinking that we have only the capacity to do abstract thinking and we are weak in applied work. That's not true. What is true, however, is that time it takes to translate any fundamental research to a device or applied kind of practical application, that is inordinately and inexcusably long in this country. It's extremely short in the more successful countries. And that's something that needs to be looked into immediately. And overall, of course, because of this long tail that Professor Baskaran mentioned, and Professor K.Kembhavi very rightly mentioned, the average is brought down and it needs to be pushed up definitely. But once again, if you do a scientific analysis of this, and there's a model actually, a mathematical model, which I'll speak about this time, which will tell you how long it takes, the time scale to do this is unfortunately not in the decades, not one or two decades, but one or two centuries. It takes that much time. And that's the time it's taken the Western world also to reach a certain stage. Their science academies are 300 to 400 years old, and our science academies are about 100 years old or less. So we need to give ourselves more time. Although the world is in a great rush, we should be patient and then try to improve the quality all around. So this is crucial. But I think we should not go into this opinion that our quality is uniformly poor. That's not true. We need to build on our strengths.
Professor Bhattacharya.
So of course it is not uniform, but you know, you find some very good people, you know, Ashok Sen, and there are people like that. So it's individual. As a group, I don't think we'd work very well. Collaborations. And in larger projects, whether it is experimental work or even, you know, somebody mentioned INO, it is very fundamental, but you need a huge experiment, involvement of a lot of people. I think we need to improve our collaborative work, and only then we can. And the same thing is this minimum size, you know, it's a part of the ecosystem that unless you discuss with a large enough group and you have enough groups working on a particular topic, you cannot, even if individual people shine, we cannot make a difference overall.
Professor Adhikari.
Difficult to come up with things which have not been said already. Two points. One, I think, again, is this distinction between thinking and doing, which we emphasize too much. That needs to be rectified. We really need to integrate thinking and doing. And the other thing, I think, is that while I agree that, you know, there is a lot of variability of research, and, you know, there are people who are very good and people who are not so good, but when I see a lot of, you know, the huge number of young people who are very enthusiastic and who are very well informed at the moment, largely due to the very easy access to information that is afforded by the internet, I think that we have a really very good future ahead of us.
Professor Bhattacharya wants to add a point.
Because actually I forgot to mention this, because Professor Balakrishnan said this, that we had very good artisans. And I was talking to somebody, and I didn't want to use this word, so I'll just quote this person, he or she, I will, who said that the research in India is very Brahminical. That is brain versus brawn. Artisans do work with their hands. Intelligent people work with their brain. As long as that stays, you know, it's very difficult to break this mindset.
And if I can just add to that, I have another personal observation, which is that households which do the Saraswati Puja rarely do the Vishwakarma Puja. So one is the thinking part of the deity, and the other is the doing part of the deity. So just another observation on that division.
Professor Sunil Kumar.
Yes, I guess we already saw that average makes sense only when the distribution is normalizable. So we have a distribution which is, you know, not normalizable, quite broad and flat. And so we have some islands of very excellent people and excellent institutions, and all, they're all small islands and in this vast ocean. Okay, so we cannot talk about the average. Okay, so what we have is good people and but no community. Okay, so I think we will do well. We have good people, so they'll, you know, if you just give time, as Professor Balakrishnan was telling, that if you give time, and maybe these people will build, you know, big good communities, and the community, and then you will have good science being done. I think one indicator of that I find is journals. So for example, if you look at the number of good Indian journals, science journals, okay, so you can all see, right, how many of them are there, and are the good journals which have been read worldwide and things like that. And so that is an indication of community. Okay, if you have good community and scientific community working on something, and then there will be people, there will be good journals around. And I always cite the Russian journal as an example of that. There was a time, right, when everybody actually read, okay, you probably would not know, they read Russian journals, people got it translated and read, because there was there was a big scientific community in Russia which is doing important work, and there were these things, and people wanted to know what they were doing, okay, and they were publishing only in Russian journals, okay, and so people were looking for that. And you can see that has declined, and that also shows that the Russian science has also gone down a bit. Okay, so this is the same way we would see that when Dijon was in this, very active at that time, all people who worked in soft matter always read French journals. Okay, and again, as a student who was starting to work in soft matter, I had to get many of the French things translated to read. But it was important to read them because there was all there. So because there's this community there. There's not one person, it's just a community. So if you have a community, then you will get importance and people will start reading your thing. It doesn't matter where you published our own journals because of the other. So that is the main problem which we have now, okay, that we have good people, okay, and doing very good work, okay, but we have not started working as a community. That's my observation.
Sure, please, Professor Balakrishnan.
The idea of the community for anything, a scientific community in any area, is absolutely crucial. I'd just like to observe that 40 to 50 years ago, in a scientific conference in any subject, a very specialized subject, you probably found only about 20 or 25 people in the country. And the conference in the same subject the next year had pretty much the same people over again. Today, that number is of the order of 200 to 300. So it's certainly a huge difference in the community, slowly but surely getting built up. And that's a prerequisite for this whole thing.
So we have two or three questions in this regard. I'm reading in a certain order, which I feel is important. The first is, you know, related to the quality of research. Does the increase in the number of PhDs will have a negative impact on the quality of research in India? Anyone?
Contrary, I think it'll improve the quality.
Okay.
Because the more number of people think about important problems, there is more opportunity to contribute to that field. And
so there is no relation to the lack of quality and the number and the quantity we have to deal with?
See, there may be some transient phenomena which looks like lack of quality. But on the whole, we need a large base of research activity, a very large base. Then in that, many, many nice things will come. So at the beginning, there may be some problem. The number of research scholars we have is for per capita is abysmally low. We have so many bright minds. We have to bring it. I don't think it will become bad.
Anyone else?
There is a little bit of a matter of detail here. Because like Baskaran said, if you increase the number of researchers, obviously the temperament is going to build up and things will improve. But that is assuming that there's a certain basic quality there. And basic sincerity. Sometimes what is happening in some of the universities now is that the PhD has been made a requirement for career advancement and so on, and so which means that there are all fake journals, fake PhDs. We are really not talking about those things. And so if you say that there's a real increase in the number of reasonable quality PhDs, then overall it will lift the subject up.
For example, within IIT context, yeah, if the number is doubled, I think it's a very positive.
But these concerns about fake journals and...
No, but I said that those are two separate things.
Okay.
One has to take into account that in different ways.
Sunil.
I would think that, you know, there is the good work would be still good work, and the good students will be still good students. And how can that change and numbers go up? See, probably you're mentioning, but the question is concerning the average.
Yes, I mean, in the sense of good increase in good quality PhDs will increase the quality. There is no concern.
Yeah.
But there are more PhDs being produced.
Just increasing the number doesn't mean that we bring down the good quality PhDs. Good quality PhDs will still be there. Okay.
No,
there may
I think if I'm paraphrasing
if you increase the number and if you're forced to increase
the number. If you just blindly increase the numbers and, you know, you are just increasing the number in the tail,
so
I think that
clear.
Is a concern.
If just increasing the number, there will be many people who did not have an opportunity to get in, would get in, and they might just do good work.
Okay.
It's just that, you know, finally, it's a control of the quality at the end.
I understand. So there.
Yeah, if I can just make one comment on this question. I mean, we see this in our institute. We have a very small institute. But I mean, if you can do this without requiring to lower the admission standards, I think it's fine. But often, you know, the pressure is that you have to lower the admission standards to accommodate the increased number of students, and then I think there's an issue.
So that's why where the quality, I'm sorry, the number of PhDs are going to come from, the tail or the rest of the distribution? Okay. So the second question is as follows. It comes in two parts. They seem related, so I'll read it out. We have a lot of institutes and good research is going on, but a lot of faculty positions are empty. what can be done to reduce this? And the second part of the question is, why not bring, on the other hand, a lot of institutes under a single roof and pursue quality research? Professor Balakrishnan.
This is the point I made in the beginning, that it's time for this country to take another look at the simultaneous existence of independent autonomous research institutes on the one hand and the educational or universe higher education system on the other. There's much closer integration of the two that's needed. And so one way or another, this is absolutely crucial. So that will solve the problem of, there are people in various institutions who are most anxious to teach, who are most anxious to interact with young students and so on, but they don't have the opportunity to do so directly. And there are research, there are institutions, educational institutions, where good faculty members are wanted, or they don't get enough people, they don't have enough people, they haven't appointed enough people. So this mismatch is really weird. And the only way to solve it is to take a national level policy decision on how to reintegrate these systems together so that the whole thing becomes a little more efficient. Otherwise, everything else is just ad hoc solutions. But the fact is that we have a huge need and there is a reasonable supply at the same time. But these two are not matched, unfortunately. So that's part of the reason why there is a problem. The solution is not to recruit faculty who are below par, simply because you don't have, by default, you recruit people who have taken up science as a default option. That is not the correct way to do it. And in that respect, one of the things that one observes about the new institutions that are set up, especially places like the ICERS, it is very gratifying to see that very high standards of recruitment are being maintained in recruiting the faculty, whereas the problem could have been solved by simply saying we'll collect a lot of people together, whoever applies is in. That would have been the finish of those institutions to start with. That has not happened in the IITs and ICERs and so on. So that's a very good sign. What's needed is, again, I repeat, a much closer integration between the research institutions, the fantastic talent there, and the good students who are in good university systems. These two people, groups of people, need to have a much closer interaction. It will help the research in the universities and the educational institutions. It will also help the research in the research institutes at the same time. If bright young minds are able to, if all of them, all the professional researchers are able to interact with very bright young minds without any barriers between them.
Thank you. Thank you, Ajit. The next question is as follows. One of the ways in which the quality of research is judged are quantitative metrics such as citations and impact factors. Can you comment on the relevance of these measures today in the context of open access movements such as the archive and also the idea of post-publication peer review? This is from Nityanand Rao. Can you repeat the question? One of the ways in which the quality of research is being judged are quantitative methods such as the citation and the impact factors, H index and impact factors, etc. Your view on the relevance of these measures today in the context of open access movements such as the archive and also the idea of post-publication peer review. Professor Baskaran, yeah. So, Ronojoy, would you, Professor Baskaran, and then.
See, any judgment based on one parameter is bound to be wrong. And particularly when the group is very inhomogeneous, it's even more wrong. That's what is happening. You know, there are some specific group where if you take H index or citation, normalized with respect to that background, it's good. But then when you sit in a committee for an award or a fellowship, you have 10, 15 different disciplines. You have no feeling, you can't distinguish between the string theorist and some polymer scientist. Both have strings, but you know. The culture is very different. One case which is very coherent, they support each other. The other case, they fight with each other. So while these H index and citation indices are all very good from individual point of view, if I have a large H index and so on, I feel happy. But on the whole, I find, you know, sitting in some committees and so on, it's not really helping.
Okay.
And particularly now in the context of, there are people whom I know who published, put their work in the archive and don't bother about publishing. And it's there for the public to see.
Is that good or bad?
No, if, okay, if they don't publish, it's bad for them.
Okay.
But what I'm saying is, it has become a very convenient weapon, you know, for committee members. You know, I have seen people don't do any preparation. They come and sit there. They say that this fellow's Hutch index is so much. They don't even read the reference letter. Ideally, you should read the reference letters and judge very carefully. So personally, I think it is doing a lot of harm with respect to even selections and so on.
Professor Adhikari.
Okay, so I'll answer the first part of the question about was that the first part, citations?
Whether, how do the citations, on one hand, citations as an impact factors versus open access efforts?
Yeah. Okay, so I'll sort of reinterpret that question to my benefit. So, I read a recommendation letter of somebody recently, and the referee had this to say that one should write papers for people who can count, but some papers should also be written for people who can read. So what he was trying to say is that, you know, all this whole business about citations, H indices, blah, 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 is all fine, but, you know, you have to write some papers which actually have really your scientific quality embedded in them. And, you know, there will be some people who will actually really read those papers and make a judgment about your scientific quality rather than just go by H indices. But as Professor Baskaran tells me that, you know, that apparently is actually rare. The number of people who can read apparently are rare, and I somewhat tend to agree with that. But that is really my position on the citation indices. I don't think a single parameter index, whether it's a citation index or a H index or any one of those other complicated indices, is a substitute to actually going and reading the papers. It takes much more effort to read a paper than rattle off a number, but nonetheless, it's something that has to be done. Regarding the second point about open access journals, I think journal publishing needs an absolute overhaul. We are still working in a model in which paper journals were the norm. Paper journals, by the mere fact that they could only have a certain number of pages, enforced a certain restriction on the number of papers that they could print. That restriction no longer applies to journals which are e-publication only. You can publish an arbitrary number of papers, you can publish an arbitrary length paper, you can have all different kinds of multimedia embedded in those papers. So it really needs to completely overhaul the journal publishing system, one, and second, also the refereeing system in which, you know, one or two referees seem to decide the fate of your paper. Now, I'm involved a lot in software, making software, writing software, and learning from the software movement. I mean, if some of you have used these version control systems like GitHub or SourceForge or whatever, where you can just submit your software, and, you know, people will decide through various kinds of mechanisms like starring it or whatever, whether your software is good or bad. Now, I think that entire community which decides on the quality of your product is a very good thing to do. I mean, if you just thought of it from an alternative point of view, you sent your software to two referees, they looked at your software and said, no, sorry, you can't put it up on SourceForge, or you can't put it up on GitHub. You know, the entire ridiculousness of that is what is now reflected in journal publishing, where a referee is given maybe 2 weeks to referee your paper, he really doesn't have the time, he just glances through it, he or she glances through it, and, you know, gives you some sort of referee report, which, you know, is very careless. So I think this whole thing of open access, of which archive is one part, is very important. The thing about archive is that it still doesn't have a mechanism by which you can give feedback on the paper. So there is this very nice journal started called eLife, which is only a sort of biology journal, and I'm sort of speaking up on behalf of the biologists, absentee biologists here. In that journal, it has integrated all these features of a software application itself. So you can submit your paper. After that, the referee report is completely open. So whatever the referees say is not hidden under some editorial carpet. Other authors can come and comment on your paper. And, you know, there's a continuous improvement of the paper through these comment systems. And I think that is really the future of publishing. And that is where, you know, publishing really needs to be in the next 5 to 10 years.
Any other comments? Yeah. Professor Sunil Kumar.
Yeah, so I want to comment on that. So I agree that we all look at some number or some impact factor and all of this just to judge, right? So that's what we want to judge paper. So we want to be judged. So that's why you try to publish in a high impact factor journal, because you want to say that, yeah, I publish in that impact factor 7, impact factor 25, whatever, right? So that's the reason. So, but finally, the only solution is that if you have to beat this, is that everybody start reading. That when I want to judge somebody, and I have to read. That's what Professor Baskaran was saying, that's the only solution. Now, you can go to open access, and you can say that, you know, let the all articles be there, and let the community decide, etc. But then you have to give it time. Okay, but that is true even now. Even if it is a high impact journal, you can see when it was last cited or when it was, how many times it is cited in the last few years, etc. And that kind of gives you an idea about how good that paper is. Because even a high impact factor journal, not all papers are cited equally. Okay, some, they also have engineering where they engineered ways of getting, you know, impact factor high. So they know how to do that. And the journals do, the management of journals do that thing for you. And so now all of you use social media know how to get likes and dislikes, right? And you know how to engineer that, right? So even if you go into a community thing, okay, you know how to engineer that, okay? If you want to get a lot of, you know, references to that, a paper which put in public forum, and then you will do that somehow, okay? You will, so there's no way to beat that. Okay, finally, that you have to read the paper, and if you want to make a judgment on something, you read the paper and then you see. That's all you can do.
Professor Balakrishnan.
The irony is that the H index was initiated originally with the idea of evaluating institutions and not individuals. That's very unfortunate that it's got translated in the process and it's been applied to individuals. But it was not meant for that initially.
People actually do that. They manipulate their H index because they have papers which they, their own papers, they refer to, which has no relevance to what they're writing right now, okay? Just because, you know, getting H index, that is important. So people do that.
I just wanted to add, you all don't go for blood tests. We have to go for blood tests every now and then, and there are numbers, and they give this range, and it always says that you need the advice of a clinician. So H index is like that. You know, you have to read the paper, otherwise you don't know what the quality is.
So, there is another question related again to the quality of research. It reads as follows. Germany has 9 technical universities, but it does excellent in especially applied mechanics and automobile engineering. While India has so many IITs, IITs and other institutions like TIFR, BARC, ISRO, ICER, NICER and IAC, why India is not regarded as at least a pioneer in a single area? Does this show the quality of research in India is lower than as compared to other countries? Yeah, Ronojoy.
I've been trying to make this point for a while without being really forcefully making it. I think there's a deep connection between industrial growth and basic science. And if you just look at the history of scientifically advanced countries in the last 100 years, there's a very strong correlation between industrial growth and basic science research, whether that be in a capitalist economy like in Europe or even in a socialist economy like in Russia. Okay. So in the particular context of this question, we've never had a very strong automobile industry. I mean, what we have had has been the ambassador company in, you know, the whatever, Hindustan Motors, and, you know, they've just taken second-rate technology and regurgitated it over and over again over the years, and there's been no impetus for improving the quality of the cars. And now with this nascent industry here, both from abroad and from Indian companies, I think there will be a demand for basic science which will, you know, improve the quality of automobile engineering in particular and various other kinds of engineering. And, you know, some of us are actually involved in creating software which will simulate the airflow around cars, for instance. And, you know, that's something that would have been unthinkable for us, you know, 20 years back, that we could actually make such a software and actually try to get Indian industry interested in it. But it is happening. So I think that, you know, given enough time, we will see these kinds of changes happening. And, you know, there will be an improvement in science, basic science.
Any other comments? Yeah, Professor Balakrishnan, yes.
I agree entirely. Like I said, there are actually mathematical models for this. And it turns out, under very realistic assumptions, the time taken, like Professor Adhikari mentioned very specifically, you need to link the industrial revolution or the industrialization of a country with the technology and science base of this country. It takes time. It doesn't work in decades. It doesn't, it's all the models, if you look, put realistic numbers there for various parameters, then the figure turns out to be in the order of a couple of 100 years. And that's been the experience of Europe. There are small exceptions like the large number of Nobel laureates in America after the Second World War due to the large influx of European talent in there. That's an anomaly. But otherwise, if you ask about the quality of the science academies in these countries, for instance, takes 250 years to get science academies in which the very best people are present as fellows of the academy and so on. India is very young in that respect. In the modern era, it takes time. It'll take a year, 100 years or 150 years. But of course, we are on the path, and I feel very optimistic about it. But there are no quick fixes in this business. That's the problem.
Ronojoy, please go.
Just an anecdote to it, what Professor Balakrishnan is saying. If you look at some of the early research that fellows of the Royal Society were doing in the 1600s, you'll be amazed, rather appalled, at the kinds of things that they were interested in. I mean, they're actually not even scientific things. But you know, you can see what the Royal Society has become in 400 years.
Okay.
Universities versus the quality of research he's talking about. I know, like, that is also related to the question which is asked earlier, that we have now started a lot of institutions and we have not filled up faculty positions, as somebody mentioned. And also that, you know, we have increased the number of PhD things, and which is with the aim to fill up those positions, and but we have not, are we getting the good quality there output? So these things don't happen overnight. So we right now, you know, the, as Ronojoy said or mentioned, that the economic growth or our industrial growth and our just generally social system or the social situation is very different from what is there in Germany. So I think it's not a fair comparison at all. So we can just increase the number of universities and the number of PhD positions, but what are we getting? Okay, what are we doing at the level of schools? First we have to do the level of schools and probably do the level of high schools, and then only we would get good students to come into the universities, and then from there only we can expect to get them to go to the PhD and then finally do the faculty positions and then go to that level, right? So it takes some time. Maybe we are not working hard enough at the school level and high school level to get this process started.
Sure, please, Professor Balak.
I'd like to add something to this. I didn't want to bring it up here because I thought this may not be the right forum, but let me say it anyway because it's something that should be in the back of all of us, especially the young people, the next generation. Our population is 1.2 or 1.3 billion, whatever, but our entire scientific base, our entire technological base comes from a maximum of 40 to 50 towns and metros, a few metros and 40 to 50 towns, second tier, third tier towns. We have about 900 million to a billion people left out of the loop altogether. So in that sense, we are not a huge country. We are France plus Germany. That's it, plus Italy in terms of population. And without the backing of scientific progress and technological development that those countries have had. So that's the problem. So all of us need to ruminate over this. If our base had indeed been, our starting point had indeed been 1.2 billion, we would have, by sheer statistics, we would have had a certain number of Nobel laureates, we'd have had a certain number of first-rate people and everything. But unfortunately, our starting base is only 1/10 probably, or 1/5 at best, of what our potential starting base is. So that's what requires first remedying to start with, that everybody has an opportunity at the initial stage so that talent gets thrown up, sufficiently wide base is there, and then talent will emerge automatically. We're really working under tremendous handicap. We've handicapped ourselves in that sense. So that is worth thinking about.
I have a couple of other questions which have been handed over to me, but I somehow feel that doesn't immediately correspond to what we are discussing. So we will come back to these questions at the end of all three questions. So let's move to the third topic. The questions are as follows. How should young researchers go about with the challenge of improving the quality of their research? How can this process play a big role in the overall picture of, say, helping India move forward? Professor Baskaran?
So go about the challenge of improving the quality of their research.
Absolutely.
I think the first thing is research scholars should take challenging problems. Just do not listen to your guide alone. just don't do what your guide is asking you to do. I think that's very, very important, because you are here for 3 to 5 years. You should develop independence right from the beginning and think about challenging problem and talk to people, talk among yourselves, and if you have chosen some particular field, what are the challenging issues, what are the challenging problems, start thinking about it, rather than often doing the increment problem that your professor suggests. Now, he may like to use you as a pair of hands. Please don't yield to that. So try to be independent right from the beginning and really take challenging problems. I don't have anything else to say, you know. Thank you.
Professor Balakrishnan.
I'll say it in telegraphic language. Read, discuss, attend seminars, ask questions, and think about the problem all the time.
Can either of you comment on how it can play a role in a larger role in making India forward? How individual?
I think, see, these guys are the future. The research scholars are the future. Once they start doing better, the whole country
will bring the average up.
There is no question about it. I think we have a great potential.
Professor Bhattacharya.
And in fact, to add to what Bala said, this morning I was cursing the research scholars at our institute. See, because we had, there is something called Chennai Science Club. It meets once in a month. So many nice things are discussed. This time, there were 3 talks. 2 mathematics colleagues spoke about Abel Prize that was given this year to Nash and another gentleman, I forget the name. It's like Nobel Prize. And then another person talked about Nobel Prize for Physics. So I once in a year, you know, year get excited and write to students, please attend seminars and talks. So I did in the same way 4 days ago. There was a fantastic response, 0 students from math science. So I think it's very important for you to attend seminars, because these days I see there is a tendency to completely avoid colloquia and seminar. And you are doing it at your peril. Because, I mean, many of us, when we grew in research institutions, for various reasons, we attended all seminars. And through osmosis, you know, things got in, and some seminars that I attended 20 years ago or 30 years ago is helping me now. So please don't ignore seminars and colloquia.
Professor Bhattacharya.
Yeah, I think Sunil mentioned this. So the quality of research cannot come, I mean, the base has to start, right? So school, what we do in school, what we do in college, and then masters, and then you come here. So many of you may not have been exposed or have the background. And even when we sit in interview committees and all, we don't look for knowledge, but we see how, if they can think in the right way. Given enough number of hints, can they get to the answer? So once you've got in, you're good. You know, you say that whatever is the problem, I should be able to do it, right? And then prepare the background. You know, there is a library, there are so many resources, there are so many people to talk to. And I agree with Professor Baskaran, you should not become the hand of the guide, but please don't dismiss the guide either. Guides usually, you know, have done something to become guides, right? So do trust them, they have your welfare, and if you do good work, of course it will reflect on the guide, vice versa. If you do bad work, it also reflects on the guide. So they have something at stake too.
Professor Adhikari.
Yeah, I would say aim really high. Aim as high as you can, and treat the world as your competition rather than, you know, your lab mate or whatever or whatever. I mean, just look at whatever research you're doing, find out what's the best quality of that research being done in the world and try and emulate that, whatever it takes. And I think as Professor Balakrishnan mentioned, it takes an obsessive mind to be creative. You really have to put all your focus into your research when the time is there to do the research, right? You can't be distracted by other things. You just need to be absolutely obsessive about the work you're doing for you to be creative.
Professor Sunil Kumar.
I guess by young researchers, you mean PhD students, I don't know.
I guess, yes.
So my advice is that, you know, so two things I want to say. One is that don't do research to publish. And but you should publish, because just like you have to write exams to go up when you do courses, right? But you're not doing courses to get degrees, right? You're trying to learn something. Similarly, as a PhD student, I think it is you should not be doing research just to publish and to get a degree. That's not the idea, right? Because there is a slight difference between a PhD, being a PhD student, or just a project associate, right? You join a project and be a project associate. That's different from being a PhD student. Otherwise, you know, we don't need a PhD program. We just need, you know, that people do research, and when they write two papers, they get a PhD degree, right? So that's not what we mean with that. So there is a PhD program in which there is a training, right? At the end of it, you become independent researcher. So you have to keep that in mind, that I want to become an independent researcher and I want to do good work on my own, okay, and I just move forward. So I had to acquire whatever is required for that, okay? That's what you should do. And of course, there's a limited time to do all of that, and in between you also have to publish, okay? So, but you know, so you have to balance that. So, but your main point is that, you know, this 5 years, which normally what you so expected to spend, you would be, you know, trying to, you should try to acquire as much expertise to become an independent researcher. At the end of it, you should be an expert on something. So you should always look at that. You know, am I becoming an expert on something? Like, what is the training I am getting? Okay. That is that. Then how many papers am I going to publish? So I think that's, if you do that, I think you would succeed later. Even if you start with lower number of papers in the beginning, maybe you will have, you know, you'll have chances of doing it better later.
Yeah. Improves the nation, because you go back and teach in colleges and you improve the level of colleges. You join DRDO, ISRO, fly, you know, next launch, Mangala, and next stage, etc. So that's how it improves.
Professor Balakrishnan.
Sunil's last point about your becoming an expert in something is worth remembering, because I think when you write an original PhD dissertation, there is that little epsilon of knowledge, no matter what it is, in which you have to be the world's leading expert. Number one, not two, not three. More than your guide, more than even your guide. You have to know more about this little epsilon than anybody else in the world. Only then is it original. So you have to aim for a dissertation, aim your work in such a way that in your dissertation you present some knowledge in which you are the leading expert, the number one expert. No matter how small this advance is, it has to be yours. So that should be the target in a thesis.
Okay, I have two questions and one actually a comment. I will read the question first. Many top journals accept and encourage collaborative research interests, but the scenario in India is like professors of the same department do not want to share research ideas and collaborate. Then how come we expect that from their graduate students and expect a higher quality of research?
I have to say it is improving. I think part of the reason was also, you know, this pie they say, how big is the pie, how many people can share it. So there was the funding was not that good, and people were scared about giving acknowledgement to people. But I'm happy to say I think it is much better now.
Yeah, Professor Balak.
In lighter vein about people collaborating, I'd like to give as to why, if their guides are not collaborating, why the students should collaborate or talk to each other and so on. Let me say it purely as a joke. Very often when students don't attend seminars, and I tell them, please go and attend seminars, I've heard in the past remarks like, even my guide doesn't attend it, to which my response has always been, it's too late for him. So I think the same answer applies here too.
Any other comments? Yeah, Sunil.
I mentioned that in the beginning that we don't work in a community, we don't have a big group, but the idea of working in a group, I think it is changing. We probably have, as Professor Balakrishnan said, that you do see a larger number of people attending meetings, etc. these days. So maybe we are changing, and you can see that at least now, you know, coming back to the high impact journals, if you want to get a high impact journal publication, you need to have collaborations. You can see that you need to put in various different expertise which you don't have, which one person may not have. Okay, so I think we will also pick up that. And I think the another reason why we don't collaborate so much, there is always this, you know, this maybe the frog in the well kind of thing, you know, so thinking, like, how can I share something? It's like, I am, so I cannot share that. That kind of a feeling is there. I'm saying frog in the well in the sense that what I'm saying is only this, that's what I meant actually. No, I didn't mean that, I didn't mean that sharing, yeah. I mean the sharing the credit is what I meant, not sharing the thing. So this thing about looking at the sky above and saying that that's the world which you see, and then you know, you are a king in that thing, and then you know, how can you have anybody else taking your credit away, kind of thing. That's what, and so that also is changing. And I was my thing is that, you know, like if you collaborate with anybody, you can also collaborate as a student. Also, you can collaborate with other people, and you know, just don't be, you know, bothered about, you know, what you get out of it. As long as you learn something, okay, you have learned at the end something, and then you have got a better knowledge, and that's it. So if you keep that attitude, and things will come out, everything will be fine, and then you will collaborate more, and then you will have a bigger team and to work with.
There is a comment, and the handwriting reflects a sense of agitation. So let me read it. Taking up challenging problem is a fanciful idea, but by doing so, one may be within the periphery of becoming a martyr of such an endeavor. There is no question, there is a comment. So would like someone like to comment?
This is a serious, it is a risk, it is a serious risk. And in fact, it's something that good guides are aware of when they decide what a thesis problem should be. It should be current enough that you can publish papers, the student can get his or her name on papers can be published. At the same time, it should be tractable so that the student can do it. And at the same time, it should be such, not so current and so hot that it gets finished off before the student can finish his thesis. Because the student is necessarily going to take some time to get the hang of the problem, to understand the background, to get into it and do calculations, while professionals are at it already. So this is a very tricky thing to do. And it is, yes, it's a serious problem. No easy solutions here. So invariably it turns out that in dissertations, you will discover that the knowledge there is already a little old. It's about 3 to 4 years old. But it's not in the dissertation, it's in the papers that the originality comes out, and those presumably, hopefully, should be published earlier. So it's a good idea for guides to make sure that the students write the paper and publish it even before the dissertation is written, and not wait till the end, because then they would tend to get scooped. And although it might be acceptable for the thesis, it would certainly not give enough credit to the work that's actually been done. So it is very important to learn to write a paper very fast, as soon as one can.
I guess one also has to make use of things like the preprint archive, you know, if it's not already being used. Okay, so there are a few other questions that are not immediately relevant to this topic that we discussed. So I'm just going to close the discussion on these topics and go to other questions that I have here. So the first of these questions is as follows. The panelists were comparing India with the Western world on scientific growth. Why don't we compare against countries in the Far East, such as South Korea or Singapore, which started almost at the same time?
Can I answer?
Yeah, sure, please, Professor Balakrishnan.
I don't think there was specifically a comparison with only the West or anything like that. Also, of course, advanced countries like Japan, which are scientifically very, very, very advanced, and now China, which has in the last few decades, has really become quite advanced, although they are still part of our kind of ethos here. So I think it's not just, it might have been a metaphor to say that it's the West or the developed world or anything like that, but it doesn't necessarily have to be North America or Europe, Western Europe or anything like that, not at all. Wherever there's a scientific tradition. We're comparing against countries which have had modern scientific tradition for at least 300 years, versus us, our situation where we practically started from very near scratch about 50 or 80 years ago. So that was a comparison. I don't think there was any deliberate intention to compare only against the Western world or anything like that.
Anyway, Ronojoy.
I think this is again related to my point about industrial development. So the history of India is somewhat different from the other Far Eastern countries. Our colonial experience has been much longer and much more severe than other countries like China, Japan, or Korea. Japan in particular started industrializing much ahead of us in what is called the Meiji Restoration period in Japan, where they were very conscious about replicating the Western industrial model of, you know, industrialization and growth. So they've had at least a, you know, 150-year head start on us, and that currently reflects in the great progress that Japanese science and technology has made. If you look at China, the China's trajectory has also been somewhat alike, somewhat similar, because it has also had a somewhat colonial experience, which has retarded industrial growth. But now, you know, since the last 30, 40 years, it has made a remarkable transformation into industrial growth, and, you know, that is reflecting in its science. So I think maybe if we are to, you know, replicate the models of scientific growth, it is better to look at the Far East, which shares to a certain degree the kinds of experiences that we have shared, rather than directly try to import a model from the West.
Professor Sunil Kumar.
Yeah, I think the China is actually maybe a good comparison, how they have come up compared to us. Maybe we started off, we all feel that we started off similar maybe many years back, and but now, you know, very clearly they are ahead of us. But that is actually not really true, I think, because China has invested quite heavily in school education sometime maybe 30, 40 years back. Again, they're seeing the effect of that now. That's one thing which they did. Very heavily they invested in the school education. And another thing which is that they, even though they had very few people doing research, and those research was very local, self-contained, and they were own ideas, and they were developing their own processes. And when the West was developing the processor, for example, okay, so their technology, there are a lot of, you know, indigenous technology which is being developed there. So that is very different from what our thing is. We have been always, you know, taking things from the over, always means the past many decades. You know, we have not focused on our own ideas, our own teams of doing, developing things and technology from the scratch. Okay, this is some different which you see. In fact, I was reading this book by Herbert Simon on models of my life, and in which he actually mentions that during the 60s, how they made an effort to go to China to see what they have developed in terms of computers, because they knew that they have developed many things, and so they go there to see what the advancement of computer science there is. So it's, even though we see that, you know, they suddenly come up, that's not directly true. They have been working on it hard for quite some time. So maybe we'll also, you know, come up if you work hard on our basic education and then also on the university education.
Professor Bhattacharya.
You know, there's no comparison in the level of funding in China and in India. It is orders of magnitude larger. A. B, they open this institute and everyone has to work in this aspect of biotechnology. Will it work here? It doesn't even work in a lab that you try to make three people work on the same thing. Because we want researchers to be free, academics, no boss, etc. That's not the way it runs in China. We keep comparing with China. Do you also even want to be like that?
I should mention, if you
they also, I think they did invest quite heavily on in school education for 30, 40 years back, and so they
do. Ronojoy, you wanted to say something?
No, I'm just trying to bat for China a little bit.
Please.
So I'm saying that, you know, for me the choice is, if you have to make scientists work in a sort of dictatorial fashion, and that solves your problem of huge societal problems that we face, maybe that is something that I could live with for some part of time, you know. Yeah, I know this is provocative, but...
No, it's not. You can do it. For example, there's funding in nanotechnology. Whole of India is working, well, not whole, a large part of India is working on nanotechnology. You can do it indirectly like that. But you can't dictate, no?
So I should mention, if you have questions, you know, kindly raise your hand and someone will come and ask you to, you know, give you a sheet of paper to write in, and we will eventually also pass the mic around to, you know, find out whether there are questions. So The rest of the questions are of generic nature, not necessarily corresponding to any of these particular themes. I'm going in a certain order. Or joint PhDs like IITM, NUS, IITB, WS, etc., better than normal PhDs from IITs or NUS separately? Do joint PhDs get more value than normal PhDs globally?
Unless there is an existing collaboration, I don't think these joint PhDs degrees have any meaning. If there is existing collaboration between NUS and IITM, and you join, of course, it'll have value. You'll get exposed to a different kind of system and, you know, equipment, whatever it is. But if you take a student and then decide to start a collaboration, I don't think that's very good.
Okay. So the next question is, should we promote reservations in research as well without differentiating students and professors? I don't understand the last part, but I think the question is whether should we promote reservations at the level of research as well? Okay, there exists. Okay, all right. So let me move on to the next question. How research in basic sciences is going to make an environment, create an environment of scientific temper in Indian society? Let me repeat. How research in basic sciences will help create an environment of scientific temper in Indian society? I guess, will it help create an environment, larger environment of scientific temper? Yeah, please, Professor Balakrishnan.
That's a very difficult question because, as you know, the constitution of this country, Article 51(8), subclause 8, says that it shall be the duty of every citizen of this country to promote the spirit of scientific inquiry and to develop scientific temper and the spirit of rational inquiry. It's a duty, it's everyone's duty as part of the constitution of this country. Probably one of the few constitutions which actually enjoins upon its citizens to be scientific minded, to be rational minded, and so on. But having said that, we all know that we live in a milieu in which the laws of black body radiation apply on the blackboard, and it's astrology outside that plane. So we know that too. But I think the absence of scientific research is certainly not going to help promote the spirit of scientific temper and inquiry. Its presence may or may not, depends on the sociology of the people, but I think I have hope for the younger generation because they would be relatively unbrainwashed and they would, with early exposure to science and scientific inquiry, eventually a lot of these superstitions and so on will die because they will educate other people around them and so on. It's again a very slow process. Societal change is always very slow in this regard. If it's fast, it's also very precipitous and could be reversed. If it's slow, it's going to hold, it's going to last. So I think we need scientific research, we need much more, and we need to tell people very clearly that science and superstition are not compatible with each other. The problem is not that we lack scientific temper, the problem is that we tend to think as a race, as a people, if at all we have a fault, one of them is that we tend to compartmentalize in our minds and actually rationalize in our minds the simultaneous existence of really terrible superstitions along with the most fundamental scientific principles. But we need to understand that these two are not compatible with each other. That'll take a long time. It'll take the younger generation growing up in a spirit of scientific inquiry to be able to fully realize the potential here. But this is a transition generation. My generation is a transition generation. It was not so long ago that even astronomers took ritual baths after eclipses, saying that this is this and that is that. And this, of course, you know, there's a stage when it comes to personal freedom and so on, faith and so on. These are different issues altogether. But as far as the spirit of scientific inquiry is concerned and the understanding that you need to have a rational outlook in daily life, in making decisions and so on, I think it will take a while for it to percolate. But certainly an atmosphere of scientific research in the country will help, will go a long way towards breeding this kind of temper. It won't do harm, and I think it will help in the positive direction.
If I can make a remark in this regard, I have seen perfectly high quality physicists having a religious view and being ritualistic about it as well. I used to be very rigid in my views about this. After some time, I think they work with different parts of their system to deal with this.
Well, I was careful to say science was a superstition. I didn't have anything to say about religion or faith or anything of that kind. So.
Okay.
Science was a superstition. And these are very different things. They're not compatible with each other.
Ronojoy.
Yeah, I think just an example of what Professor Balakrishnan has said, that presence of scientific, basic science or scientific research may or may not lead to a general rational outlook. You have a very clear example of that, of the creationism movement in the United States, which is supposed to be the most scientifically advanced country, yet you know, large parts of the population actually do not believe in the theory of Darwinian evolution, right? And you know, they have alternative models which are absolutely sort of pseudoscientific. And so, you know, I think that there is a very complicated sociology which leads to this kind of thing. And you know, some basic science is definitely a necessary condition, but it's not sufficient to guarantee it.
Just add one thing to what Ronojoy said. The point is that while it is true that there are people, a large fraction of their population believes in creationism and things of that kind, it is not the biologists who are working in the forefront of evolution who believe in the same thing simultaneously. It is this simultaneous belief in science and superstition that we are unfortunately saddled with in many cases, and that's probably detrimental.
But again, that could be universal, right? I mean, it's not peculiar to India. So let me go to the next question. It says, one of the panelists had said that the time taken to convert an idea or a paper, research paper, to a useful device is very, very long in India. Why is that, and what is the reasons, and what could be the solutions?
That comment about the time taken to translate an idea into a practical device or an application is very long. The easy way out, I'm not the expert in this, I don't do applied physics, so I don't know the answer really, but the answer I've heard being given very often by people who are doing applied physics and who have felt frustrated in their efforts to get their ideas translated into reality is that our industry is blamed, saying that they are looking for quick profits and they would like screwdriver technology rather than invest money in research and development where you can translate an idea or a pure laboratory scale demonstration into an actual industrial prototype of some kind. So at that stage, it's industry being blamed, saying that they're looking for quick profits and this is a thing which takes a lot of time and investment plus a lot of risk also because it may or may not work. I don't know how far it's true, but I think now the problem is being addressed in the sense that young people are, it is no longer a stigma in this country to have a startup and have it fail. That I think is the key. And at that stage, the problem will get sorted out because the fact that young people are being encouraged to become entrepreneurs, to do startups, to take their idea and you yourself go ahead. And there are people, there are angels, there are who venture capitalists and angels who will fund you to a certain extent for you to try to translate this. That's probably the way to go and not wait for some massive governmental intervention or policy for it to happen. So I think it will happen. It is going to happen. This time scale will get reduced enormously and it is already starting to happen.
Sunil.
With all this tightening of intellectual property rights, etc., we will be forced to do more research and then development.
So the next question is somewhat related to the comments that are being made. Is our research culture sustainable? I mean, we are too much dependent on the government. Why are we not dependent on private industries?
I think it's the same reason that the private industry, as said earlier, that was more interested in screwdriver technology and then that. But now I think it is changing. It is changing. We can see that now in our research park.
There's
so many companies have now.
Which are being incubated.
And I think there is a need now to do research and develop our own products because otherwise, you know, you cannot, because of the tightening of the intellectual property, basically. That's maybe the main reason.
While that may be true, industry is not willing to give money. You know, they are willing to give 100 rupees and expect 1 lakh in return. And that is true. In fact, Professor Krishnakumar wrote that article in Economic Times that, you know, anytime there's a cut in tax, industrialists keep complaining about it. But what have they contributed, even these big houses, towards research? They've not done much. They open They give chairs in Harvard and lots of other places. They don't contribute money to universities in India.
So the next question is somewhat longer, so let me try to read it. Is it good to create a group responsible for identifying problems faced by humans, either problems belonging to engineering, medical, agricultural, public transport, or any other fields, and pass them to corresponding research institutions to tackle that tackle these basic problems? The questioner believes that this kind of researches directly impact human life. Can the panelists comment on this? I think the point is, do we need to create research institutions to directly deal with problems that correspond to important problems facing human life in India?
What deity office to the principal scientific office to the prime minister? That's what they do. You know, there's a think tank and they decide that these fields need to be worked into. And of course, locally also it is done. You know, in IIT itself, mechanical engineering, people are working on wheelchairs, assistive technology. Locally it's done, but also these organizations, as I said, DATI has a think tank, Prime Minister's office has a think tank. They think of these problems and pass it on. It is done already.
So just give me a minute, I'm trying to see. So there is another comment which is partly related to Sunil commenting about schools and so on. In my view, more than anything else, we need to upgrade our school curriculum. For example, even after 100 years, relativity is still alien to us. So I guess there is a comment about the schools, you know, not teaching enough to the students, school education not being up to the mark. Yeah, Professor Balakrishnan.
I had very recently some occasion to look at the 11th standard and 12th standard science portions for the CBSE. And out of curiosity, in this exercise we undertook in a panel a few years ago, we stacked together all the textbooks of the 11th and 12th standard, physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology, on the floor, and we had no problem, it went above the table height. So I don't think the amount of material is a problem. I think it's probably too excessive. We probably teach far too much. It is excessive by about 50%, I'd say. I feel that we'd be much more efficient if we cut down the total science content of the plus two level in terms of factual information, if we cut it down by 50% and focused on 50%, which is relevant. Because at a later stage, when somebody specializes in physics, for example, these topics can be picked up much faster and much more efficiently. This philosophy is already known to us. It's already been realized. Because if you look at all the new integrated programs in the universities, they're trying to now teach biology to the students who did mathematics and vice versa. They have bridge courses, remedial courses, and so on. They're coming to the idea that you shouldn't declare your major for the first 2 years. You should actually get a broad liberal education and then declare the major. What is being done is to try to undo the harm that's been done by super specialization or premature specialization at the plus two stage. So it's been realized. This has been realized. So I think the next logical step is not to add more material to what's being taught in the plus two, but to change the nature of the material that's been taught and the way it is taught. And the idea focus should be on understanding concepts, understanding broad general principles, making sure that you know how to apply things to situations, how to solve problems and so on, rather than increase the amount of factual information. Let me just, with the permission of the chair, say what happened to me in an anecdote, which will illustrate the point. Many years ago, I was in the Board of Studies for a college where they actually had in the modern physics syllabus, they had the Bohr model of the atom, and then they had the Bohr-Sommerfeld model of elliptic orbits, and then they had quantum mechanics, all in the same syllabus. So I asked, what's the purpose of the Bohr-Sommerfeld thing in the middle? The Bohr model of the atom, there's a reason for it, which is not explained actually in that syllabus. The reason is it tells you what the classical quantum correspondence is, but they retained it as an elementary introduction. But what was the need for that wrong blind alley into which people went in the beginning when they tried to improve the Bohr model by adding elliptic orbits and so on? I said, what's the need for that? Get rid of it. And the answer given to me was, it's a very nice 30-minute question.
So seriously, I mean, this is a nice, very compact 30-minute question and so on. So I thought I'd, you know, try to bring the home point home a little more forcefully and said, well, if you're going to do this, then in the classical mechanics portion, you should include, now in addition to Kepler's orbits, you should also include Ptolemy's idea of epicycles and so on. I thought I was being sarcastic and the point would come across, but it fell flat because they asked me, members of, in which book is it given so that we can include it? So this is our problem. We have too much factual information and far too little understanding and so on. So we should actually try to reduce the amount of material that we try to force feed these children and improve the quality of the nature of this knowledge that we're trying to do it, make them think a little bit more. For instance, even in the humanities, I'd say the same thing. If you look at the textbook on humanities, you have enormous amounts of material to be read and memorized, very little in the form of criticism or critique. I'd rather say, instead of teaching 1,500 poems, teach them 5 or 10 or 50 and say, try to improve this. Try to see if you can improve it. Critique, make a critique of it and so on. That's the thing that we need to develop in our education system, critical thinking, and that's the one thing that's conspicuously absent, unfortunately.
Okay, I think we are running out of running out of time for further questions. We have many questions. Unfortunately, we are running out of time. I would just like to ask the panelists whether they would like to make any closing remarks in some manner. Professor Bhattacharya.
I think it is optimistic and you all should work hard. And you know, you have a lot to conquer. There's a whole life ahead of you. I think things, research, jobs, everything is very good now. We are all on an upward path.
Thank you. It's going to be a challenge for me to try and summarize, so I'm not going to even try it, summarize the discussion. It's been so varied, and the questions have been varied as well. So I'm just going to close by thanking all the panelists for sparing the time to be with us. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.